Dear ladies and gentlemen, I want to tell you why I think it is necessary to create a new German-American institute, which I want to call Schiller Institute, to fight for the further existence of the Western Alliance, the alliance between the United States and Western Europe. Because it is right now the key priority of Soviet strategy to separate the United States from Western Europe. I'm unfortunately convinced that this development is very far advanced and that the decision if Western Europe and the United States remain together in one alliance will be made in the next couple of weeks, at best month. Because the outcome of the US election campaign will be decisive in this matter. And I just want to tell you what are the options for this scenario, which, as I said, the Soviet Union is right now putting the utmost emphasis on. If any combination of Walter Mondale or Gary Hart would win the presidency, it is unfortunately already a precluded fact that Western Europe would split from the United States. Both Mondale and Hart have made statements to the effect that they want to pull out troops out of Western Europe, which immediately would mean that West Europe would fall under the hegemony of the Soviet Union. Unfortunately, because of the recent developments around the White House, the total Kissinger takeover of the Reagan administration, as of now, if Reagan would be re-elected, which I think is not very likely as things are going now, unfortunately, we have to take very serious what Kissinger said in his Times magazine article, which was published on March 5th, where he also proposed a massive US troop reduction out of Western Europe. And it has been the absolute joint opinion of all West European military and other forces that if US troops would be pulled out of Western Europe right now, then the Soviet Union would have a very easy time of swallowing Western Europe. So therefore, because both Mondale, Hart, as well as the masters of Kissinger are really controlled by the same forces, namely the Eastern establishment, those liberals who are committed to divide the world up in a new Yalta agreement with the Soviet Union, that in any case, let it be Mondale, Hart, or let it be a Kissinger-dominated Reagan administration, Western Europe would be split. Unfortunately, President Reagan, which for electoral reasons or whatever compromises he thought he had to do, is following right now on his present China trip, a script which has been worked out by the Kissinger forces. He made a statement to the effect where he said that the future of the United States is in the Pacific area. The medias have played him as a Pacific president. And the only significance of this is to give a signal to the decoupling forces on both sides of the Atlantic to go ahead with their decoupling schemes. I want to tell you now why it would be devastating for world civilization and for the security of the United States if this would occur. I know that the medias in the United States have really made many, many efforts to portray Western Europe as disloyal, as people who don't want the Americans, and so forth and so on. And I'm quite aware that many people in the United States say, okay, if the Europeans don't want us, if they turn anti-American, if they are ungrateful, why should we bother to think and be concerned about their defense? Well, the reality is different. First of all, the peace movement, the radical part of the peace movement, is not the majority of the Europeans. The majority of the Europeans want the alliance with the United States because they understand perfectly well that if the United States would stop being concerned in an alliance with Europe, then indeed Soviet hegemony and maybe even worse, military occupation would soon be a reality in Western Europe. The other aspect, which I think is very crucial for Americans to understand, that right now Western Europe is very weak. It's politically disunified. The EC has practically collapsed. You have mass unemployment. You have a mass strike process. You have chaos. You have terrorism. So Western Europe looks really very weak. But if you look at it from a different point of view, if you look at the totality of the industrial capacities and the skilled labor force of Europe as a whole, then this is a slightly larger potential than that of the United States. And if you would add the industrial potential and the number of skilled labor force in Western Europe, and you would add that to the potential of the Warsaw Pact, well, that makes, unfortunately, a very simple calculation, namely that that complex of the Warsaw Pact and Western Europe would simply mean the largest industrial complex and therefore military power in the world. And very soon afterwards, the United States would be reduced to a relatively third-rate power, and Japan, under such conditions, would also very quickly drift away towards this center of gravity. And, you know, soon the Soviet Union would quite easily establish world hegemony. Therefore, I think if you think about these facts, we cannot afford to lose Western Europe. I said already, the situation is very far advanced. The recent Soviet naval maneuvers in the North Atlantic have not only been the largest naval maneuvers of the Soviet Union ever in history, but they have demonstrated quite clearly that under conditions of any war, then these naval forces of the Warsaw Pact would be able to separate the United States logistically from Western Europe. There is a full-fledged Berlin crisis going on, which is very dangerous because all the Western powers, the so-called four powers of West Berlin, basically do not react. And that is very dangerous. The DDR government practically has said that they don't care about the four-power agreement anymore. There have been air corridor violations every day against the French, the British, the Americans, American planes. There have been provocations to the corridor of West Berlin. A French officer has been shot, and no reaction from any Western government, not the French, not the British, and not the United States. This is very dangerous because it just psychologically leaves the idea that the Soviets can do whatever they want and the West will not dare to respond, as it was the case during the last Berlin crisis in 1962. So right now, the concern of military leaders in Western Europe, and especially in West Germany, is that the Soviet Union could very easily make a surprise attack on Schleswig-Holstein or the northern plains of West Germany and just carve out what one editorialist in the German press a couple of days ago called to carve out a piece of land of the size of several ranches of Texas and, you know, basically stop then the hostile activities at that point. Because of the past history of the post-war period, nobody would assume that the NATO or the United States would want to start World War III because of some parts of land somewhere in Germany. So the Soviets theoretically could occupy this and get away with it. This is generally assumed would be the fact which would break morally the back of West Germany and of Western Europe. And if Germany goes, the rest of Western Europe goes. So basically, that is right now the situation. But it's not only the military strategic aspects why we cannot afford to lose Western Europe. I want to talk to you now, what are the so-called moral values, or the so-called values of the Free West, which we should defend and must defend, which is my conviction, if the civilization is going to survive. Well, if Western Europe would be swallowed by the Soviet Union, then we would lose European civilization, which happens to be the best civilization this world of ours has produced. That which has been produced in the last 2,500 years in European culture has produced some of the best concepts and ideas of this world. Like, for example, the idea of dignity of man, the idea of self-perfection and perfectibility of man as distinct from, let's say, animals or plants. The idea of technological progress, the idea that the creative ability of man is capable of actually fulfilling the divine action of continuing the process of creation. All this cultural heritage has, for the first time, found a political expression in the American Revolution. The American Revolution was, for the first time, the successful realization of a true republic in which each man was regarded as totally equal to the other and could stand proudly besides each other. There was no oligarchy, no princesses, no barons, and other of these strange people which nowadays make up for the jet set. But it was the idea of the equality of man. And the Republican Revolution of the US Revolution was not at all some Wild West cowboys as Hollywood movies today are trying to present it. But it was indeed a European project where the best minds of Europe indeed worked together as a Republican international alliance to help to create this new republic in the new world. It was the Republicans of Marquis de Lafayette of France. It was the Weimar Republican circles, which were headed by Friedrich Schiller. And indeed, it was the idea to create a new, true Republican state on the shores of America. As a matter of fact, this period in history, about 200 years ago, the American Revolution and the period of the German classical period, the Weimar classics, represents for both countries, for the United States and for Germany, the best historical period in their entire history. Unfortunately, this very exciting and promising approach did not succeed in the way the founding fathers had planned it. The oligarchical forces of Western Europe immediately conspired to defeat similar efforts in Western Europe to create similar republics on the old continent. Even so, the beginning phase of the French Revolution was very promising in this respect. Very soon after the Vienna Congress in 1815, the German classical period was basically defeated. Earlier, the French Revolution had been taken over by the Jacobine terror. And after 1815, Europe was thrown into one of the most darkest reactionary periods. And basically, things went downhill from thereafter. The British oligarchy tried to reverse the American Revolution after in the War of 1812, but things really started to go downhill in the United States after Lincoln was assassinated. And right now, both European institutions and the American institutions are occupied by the hairs of those oligarchical forces which fought against the ideas of the American Revolution. And these same families, the Eastern establishment, the European oligarchs, they are in a very unholy alliance right now for the decoupling of the two continents. So I said we are about to lose the best of civilization, and actually I'm convinced we are threatened to lose civilization itself if this would occur, because there are worrisome signs that the Soviet leadership is not a communist leadership anymore, but that since quite a while, other, more older forces have come to the forefront in the Soviet Union, old Russian forces of the kind Dostoevsky has described, some kind of blood and soil ideas, which, you know, in a certain sense would mean that the concern of European leaders, especially military leaders, that it's not impossible that a Khomeini-like Soviet leadership is taking over, is actually visible right now. And it's the commitment of these forces, as it was in the 30s and the 40s, to fight the values of the West, to fight the values of European culture and civilization. And it's also the same ideology which the anti-Western, anti-capitalist ideology, which a large part of the peace movement and the appeasers of today, the Neville Chamberlains of today, are actually following. The key problem right now is that all the think tanks which exist, the Aspen Institute, the Trilateral Commission, the Heritage Foundation, the Council of Foreign Relations, the Council on Germany, and so forth and so on, they are all controlled by the Eastern establishment, and they are all pursuing different scenarios for a decoupling. What is totally lacking is an institution which would express the patriotic desires of the true patriots on the European continent and on America. And therefore, I want to create a new institute which is supposed to give expression to that idea, to maintain the values of the American Revolution and the German classics. And that is why I want to call this new institute Schiller Institute, because there is no individual in this period whose ideas would be better qualified to give his name to such an effort today. I want to become this both a think tank, which is supposed to work out new concepts of the collaboration within the alliance, but I also wanted to become a mass movement where everybody is supposed to join who wants to fight for the maintenance of the alliance. On July 4th, I want to have a very big conference. I'm thinking about something like 1,000 people to come to a big conference in Washington to the founding of the Schiller Institute, where I wish to have a delegation of at least 100 Europeans who come to the United States to express that they want to maintain the alliance. This is supposed to be a vehicle for all the many people in Germany who want to be in an alliance with America, but who do not feel that in a Kissinger-run administration that they have anybody they can talk to. And this new Schiller Institute, therefore, is supposed to establish a new Republican foreign policy. If we do not like the foreign policy which is made by the Eastern establishment, there's only one answer to it. Let's take over in a Republican way the principles and define ourselves what the principles of foreign policy should be. Therefore, what is supposed to be discussed at this July 4th conference is to have four panels, one to define the military strategic principles on which the alliance between the United States and Western Europe can be maintained. And this will be and has to be, has to define concretely the kind of collaboration which West Europe and the United States would have to do in working out a joint beam technology, beam weapons program, in which several efforts to this effect have been made already, but it needs to be geared up. The second panel would be on what would be the basis for economic cooperation between Europe and Germany and the United States, where right now we have a de facto state of trade war, and there is no question that the alliance can only be saved if the present monetarist IMF policy and the high interest rate policy of Volcker is dumped, and if a new economic orientation on technological progress and a joint development of the developing sector is being made the focus for the alliance. Thirdly, there will be a panel on the joint scientific cooperation, the frontiers of science plasma physics, laser technology, and biotechnology, because only if you give the alliance some new spirit, including space exploration, you can excite the young people and give them some task worthwhile living for the future. And fourthly, the fourth panel should be on the joint history of the United States and Europe and the joint cultural foundations. I think we need to make people more conscious of the great history which we share, of the period of the American Revolution, whose ideas have been forgotten, unfortunately, today to a very large extent. We have to make them aware of these ideas again, and at the same time, of the ideas of the German classical period. But we also have to look in the more dark chapter of German-American history, and that is we have to ruthlessly reveal the mistakes which were made in the American occupation policy, the fact that the United States under McCloy, who is a representative of what is today the Kissinger forces, the mistakes which were made at the same time, namely to integrate many old Nazi networks into US intelligence services. This was the Dulles policy of collaboration with the Nazis, which is a chapter which has to be opened up, because otherwise you cannot understand the roots of pacifism, especially in Germany today. On the other side, we have to define more positively an education program so that these values of the better periods are communicated in the educational programs of both nations. I want to emphasize one thing. The world right now is in very bad shape. We are at the verge of apocalypse. We are entering a period of economic collapse, increase of terrorism, and explosion of many crisis spots worldwide. These couple of weeks decide if mankind is going to survive. And even so, the question of the European decoupling is not the only question which is threatening the world right now. It is most definitely one of the most important, because the Soviets have made it one of the most, or if not the most important issue. And there is only one candidate who is not for decoupling, and that happens to be my husband, Mr. Lyndon LaRouche. So therefore, I think that if you are against decoupling, then it's very obvious that you should support my husband. One way of doing it is to become part of this international Republican candidate movement, which exists in Europe, which exists in the United States, which is a recreation of the networks of Benjamin Franklin and the kind of effort which was made, which led to the American Revolution. But it is my firmest conviction that only if the so-called ordinary citizens are taking over policy in every respect, that this poor old world of ours has any chance. I want you to support the Schiller Institute, to become a member of the think tank, to help work out new conceptions for the alliance, or just become an active supporter of a mass movement on both sides of the Atlantic to fight for the alliance based on the spirit of the American Revolution. And I think if we are able to mobilize masses of people in this great country in the spirit of the hubris and the courage of the founding fathers, that despite the world is in a great crisis, I'm convinced if we can evoke this spirit, we can win. Thank you.